stands up is
now the
screen.
Now the stands up.
Thank you. It's always great to have Planted by Hands with us doing our music, so thank you so much. We're going to get lots more of it today, and if you didn't notice in your order of service, that's one of Brad's original pieces there. So Brad, thank you especially for helping us get off to such a beautiful start. And welcome to all of you. I want to begin, as always, by embracing all that you bring with you to our space, all of your unique beliefs, your background, your lifestyle, your experiences, your differences, all that helps make you who you are is welcome here this morning. And this includes all of those of you who are in the room with us this morning, as well as the many of you who are streaming with us. It's always great to have you joining us as well. So welcome to one and all. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, where we join together to create a nourishing, liberal religious home and to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in the wider world, or as we say in short, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice. Wonderful. I don't have any special announcements to make this morning, so I'm going to invite you all to take a couple of extra minutes to greet one another this morning. Say hi, as always, to those you look forward to seeing. Make some new friends, if there are some new friends in the building today, if you can. And if you are joining us for the first time, please don't be shy. We're very glad that you're here.
Thank you.
At age 35.
All right, I said greet one another. I didn't say start social hour. Some things don't change. Well, I'm glad to see there's a lot of enthusiasm in the room. And of course, you do get to visit during our social hour following the service, so please stay around for that. But let's move forward now by lighting our chalice, the symbol of our faith, the symbol of our unity and our solidarity, of our openness and our inclusion, of our community and our individual uniqueness. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost and cast a healthy shadow of doubt wherever it's been found.
For my opening reflection this morning, I want to share some words from Reverend Amy McKenzie Quinn. Welcome to this common sacred space. Common because we are all welcome. Sacred because here we transform the ordinary and attend to the profound. We carry with us our regrets, doubts, fears, stories, laughter. May they inspire our worship. Above all, may we each meet what we need most to find on this day in this common sacred space.
Good morning. Please rise as you're willing and able and join with us in singing together hymn number 1008 in your Till hymnal. 1008, when our heart is in a holy place.
We have a new band member this morning. Mara's going to be.
All right.
6, 7.
We are now going to kindle our candles of care for those who are most on our hearts and minds. Begin as we have been for the past many weeks now for the people of Ukraine and the rest of that part of the world that are being impacted by the war and violence there. And a candle for church member Kate Stigden, who recently broke her arm. Let's take a moment of silence on behalf of others that you might be thinking of, and as always, you're welcome to name them aloud at this time if you'd like. Those named aloud and those embraced in our silence and all those who are suffering in our world at this hour, we hold in our community with compassion. And we now gratefully give and receive this morning's offering, which helps sustain this community and our mission to the larger world.
Overflowing, what everyone can feel is living in love. beautiful day to be living. Well, everyone can feel this living in love and with you. Karen, oh, so sweet. Such a beautiful day to be sharing. Sherry.
Thanks for playing such a fun song. Children, you are welcome to come up for our time for all ages. Get a better look at our friend today. Bun Bun is back. And maybe we'll have the kids sit over on this side so you don't have to be in the way of those guitars. All right. All right, good to see everyone. Hi, Bun Bun. He says hi. I sure hope you're having a good time now that you're getting a break from bunny school. You had a lot of challenges this year, didn't you? Yeah. So what have you been up to now that you're on break? Swimming. I didn't know bunnies did that. He said he's been eating vegetables from the garden. I did know about that one. Playing in the park. Have any of you been playing in the park this summer? Yes, good. So, a water park, even better. Bun Bun, would you like a water park? Yeah, have you ever been to one? Okay, Gus, maybe you'll have to take Bun Bun to a water park. Okay. So, Bun Bun, have you made some friends at your park? Wonderful, that is great to hear that you figured out how to be a good friend. What do you like to do with your new friend? What? He said he likes to play a game called Farfaloofa. Have you ever heard of that one? No, me neither, Bun Bun. Can you tell us how you play it? Okay. Okay. Yeah. Oh. Oh, wow. That's a lot of rules, Bun Bun. I'm not sure if I got them all. Tell me, did you make up the rules yourself? Oh, okay. So he said he made up the rules with everybody else on the playground so that everybody could have a say. That sounds like a really fair way to do things, Bun Bun. In fact, it sounds a little bit like democracy. Have you heard of democracy? Okay. Have any of you heard of that word, democracy? Okay, well, sometimes in a democracy, we change the rules. Have you ever changed the rules of Farfaloofa, Bun Bun? Yeah, okay. So, our country, which is kind of celebrating its birthday this week, do you kids know what's happening tomorrow? Brooklyn, you already told me. What is it? The 4th of July, so it's kind of like a birthday celebration for our country. But when we set up our country, we set up its rules to be democratic. We change them, and in fact, lots of them are changing right now, but we're supposed to keep everybody's choices in mind. We don't always agree, and some people are left very unhappy with the changes that we make, but we know that there are democratic processes so that we can change the rules again if we need to. That's right, Bun Bun. We listen to each other. I think Bun Bun's learned a few things from our Time for All Ages stories. We have to pay attention to how our game is going and then listen to why people feel like the rules should change. I'm so glad that you're learning to share and listen on the playground. Have fun playing Farfaloofa this summer, Bun Bun. Maybe you'll have to meet us in our own new playground out back and teach us sometime. All right. Say goodbye, kids. And now join me in singing our children out.
As we move into a time of meditation, I invite you to find a comfortable position, put your feet on the floor, close your eyes if you wish, take a deep breath in and breathe out, and reflect on these words by Reverend Linda Hody. Enter with me that still place within the center where we find not only our innermost selves, but also our connection to the farthest reaches of the universe. Here, we confront our aspirations and our failings. Though we seek always to be for our lives to be full of goodness, we sometimes lack courage to right the injustices that confront us. Though we seek always to be generous, sometimes our fears cause us to be greedy. Though we seek always to walk the moral high ground, sometimes we judge others too quickly and too harshly. Though we seek always to understand the larger mysteries, sometimes doubt causes us to lose faith in our purpose. Here, in this space made sacred by our shared lives and our shared yearnings, may we find new courage, new generosity of spirit, forgiveness given and received, and rededication to the higher purposes of our lives. For our reading today, I'm going to read a portion of the Declaration of the United States and the Declaration of Independence, I should say, and the First Amendment. And I always think of these documents as representative of our highest aspirations. Than necessarily our highest accomplishments. Unfortunately, we have struggled for 200 years to make these a genuine reality in our circle of connections. But still, the values that many of us share and that our own liberal religion is rooted in. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. In the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress or grievance.
So this next song is a Paul Overstreet song. It was performed by John Denver, but it was not written by John Denver. And so when Kelly asked Todd if he knew And So It Goes, he said, of course. So I thought we had finally found something maybe he didn't know, but he knows it, so it was new to me.
We'll keep looking, though.
Yeah.
To see, like any other house, it's only temporary. Home is anywhere you choose to put your heart. If there's no love inside, it'll soon fall apart. Ashes to ashes.
Thank you so much. Beautiful. You will probably not enjoy hearing my sermon twice as much as I enjoyed hearing your song twice. So. But that was beautiful. You know, I think John Denver's songs, whether he wrote them or just sang them, continue to represent the hymnal of my life, of my true religion. Just beautiful. Thank you. So the title is The Way of Heterodoxy, and I'm going to give you an extensional definition of heterodoxy way into my sermon. So if you don't know what it is and you're frustrated, well, what the hell is he talking about? Don't worry about it. There's two kinds of definitions. There's extensional and intentional. The intention, you know, an intentional definition is where you're really, you know, go into the definition. It's kind of what you'll find in a dictionary. You know, this is the characteristics of whatever it is you're defining. And extensional, you're just pointing. You know, there's an example of it. There's an example of it. So I'm really giving extensional definition by example here. So. I'll get to the meat of it later. It's just my poor organizing. No. I actually have a saying, you know, never start a sermon at the beginning. Think about it. But I do want to start it with where we are living. The age we are living in, the time we are living in, which is a time when, in the name of greater diversity, equity, and inclusion, free thinking and free speech have been thrown under the bus. Our ideas and voices cannot be diverse, allowed equitable expression, nor all be included at our podiums, pulpits, and platforms. This doesn't mean there aren't still many different ideas out there, probably more than ever, actually, only that too many of us now divide or isolate ourselves into ideological tribes that are rigidly defined by their beliefs and by their extreme, often extreme, intolerance and hatred of others, of outsiders. Human history and societies are replete with examples of ideological suppression and division, but the extent at which it prevails today is exacerbated by the advent of social media, built on algorithms designed to keep our attention. Social media directs us toward information based upon our previous viewing habits or browsing habits, so that the information that we consume isn't very diverse, or increasingly becomes less diverse. Even worse, these algorithms, which aren't programmed to fact check, in case you didn't know, drive us towards increasingly extreme versions of the same information or of such information. In short, they lead us toward extremism. As Roger McNamee, an early investor in Facebook, now says, in their relentless pursuit and engagement of profits, these platforms called created algorithms that amplify hate speech, disinformation, and conspiracy theories. So the stage is set for the perfect storm, and today we're in it. This is our moment. This is the historical period that we are in. So American society in particular is so politically divided, I don't think anyone would deny that, that it's as if we have become two opposing countries occupying the same space. Not the first time that's happened in this country, obviously. And our divisions are not really that clean, that simple. We are not merely divided, we are divisive. Right? We're not merely divided, we become a divisive society, meaning we increasingly respond to each other with hostility over the slightest differences, which leads to lots of internal strife within groups that are actually on the same page about most things. Conservatives, including the Republican Party, have largely handled such strife by favoring their most extreme members, which helps them maintain the political strength, their political strength, that is, by sticking together, no matter how crazy they become in the process. Outliers like Liz Cheney, Adam Kinzinger, Mitt Romney, and only a handful of others tend to be repudiated, censured, and condemned as traitors. As far as a political strategy, steering the herd to move with the most extreme thinkers has worked well. But it has also made the Republican Party seem unstable, unrecognizable, and often unethical. The impacts upon progressive organizations, including the Democratic Party, have been much different. Rather than moving as a herd toward our most extreme thinkers, we continue to infight and to splinter, which keeps us politically impotent. Even when our party of choice is in power, it makes few major moves so as not to offend anyone, not even its political opponents, and is thus unable to achieve its goals or to prevent its worst fears from coming true, the overturning of Roe versus Wade by a politically weighted and extremely conservative Supreme Court was a decision that could be seen coming miles away, and yet the Democratic leadership did nothing to prevent it. In a recent article entitled "The Elephant in the Zoom," The Intercept's DC Bureau Chief Ryan Grimm tells us about the Guttmacher Institute, the abortion rights movement's premier research organization, has been locked into such internal strife that it has been unable to concentrate its energies and its resources on the organization's work. When following the killing of George Floyd, its vice president of public policy, Heather Boonstra, spoke to employees about the role systemic racism plays in society and the ways that Guttmacher's work can counter it, many of them turned their sights on what they considered the systematic racism within Guttmacher itself. According to Grimm's article, they wanted to institute the institution to loosen deadline restrictions and allow employees to take leave without any penalty, since deadlines and being at work are part of white supremacy culture. The difference, the article says, is that for Boonstra and others of her generation, the focus should have been on the work of the nonprofit. What could Guttmacher, with an annual budget of nearly $30 million, do to make the world a better place? For her staff, the question had to be answered at home first. What could they do to make Guttmacher a better place? But according to Grimm, the leaders of such groups think at least some employees are using a moment of public awakening to smuggle through standard grievances cloaked in the language of social justice. In the case of Guttmacher, employees filed formal complaints against Boonstra, which were investigated and found to be baseless. But it took a lot of energy away from the institution's mission, and Twitter groups continue beating the organization up with accusations of racism and oppression and white supremacy culture and all that. This continued even after last May, when we all learned of the Supreme Court's plan to overturn Roe v. Wade. As Grimm says, that the Institute has spent the course of the Biden administration paralyzed, making it typical of not just the abortion rights community, Planned Parenthood, Narrow Pro-Choice America, and other reproductive health organizations had similarly been locked in knockdown, drag-out fights between competing factions of their own organizations, most often breaking down along staff versus management lines. I bring this example up just to show just how destructive that this mindset can be when we need our social justice and political action organizations most. In our community, you may recall the Spokane County Democrats became entirely dysfunctional in the run-up to Donald Trump's election after its chairman was accused of racism and criticized for refusing to use the right pronouns. By people in the organization. He denied these allegations, resigned his position, and threatened to sue if the very people he had once worked with didn't stop making defamatory remarks. So we didn't have a functional party here in our county when we needed it most. And this is the point made in a recent New York Times piece by columnist Thomas Edsel entitled, "Democrats are having a purity test problem at exactly the wrong time." Edsel not only discusses how progressive organizations are being paralyzed from within when we need them most, but how they are inadvertently pushing more Americans toward the political right. That's what we're doing as progressives and liberals right now. He cites Harvard psychologist Steven Pinker, who contends that internecine conflict on the left has become a profound issue, particularly for those who are terrified that the hard woke left will enable the resurgence of authoritarian populism by inflicting damage on the moderate left and center and by driving voters to the right. Those of us with liberal values and progressive aims should thus be especially troubled by illiberalism, the illiberalism, intolerance, and destruction caused by extremism within our own ranks. While extremism on the far right has resulted in more political power for them, sadly, it is destroying the chances of those of us on the left to ever have any kind of meaningful political power again. I'm going to say that again. It is destroying the chances of those of us on the left to ever have any kind of meaningful political power again. As Edsel says, the reality is that the left and the Democratic Party have suffered bouts of internecine conflict repeatedly over the past 100 years. Unfortunately, the most powerful corrective has proved to be defeat, even repeated defeat, on Election Day. Sadly, our own Unitarian Universalist Association is also a casualty of the illiberalism crippling and destroying liberal organizations by making them inconsequential to anything meaningful. William Galston, a senior fellow of the Brookings Institute, says, "The fundamental problem is the presence in every progressive organization." And this is quite a statement. The presence in every progressive organization of a small but very vocal fringe that views every problem as a sin. In many of them, such sin is conferred by conflating minor work grievances with oppression, and mere differences of opinion with hate speech and harm. The problem with the Unitarian Universalist Association is that the small but very vocal fringe group has maneuvered its way into leadership positions that have instituted undemocratic changes in governance that will make them impenetrable for years to come. Because of this, and during the past couple of weeks, I have come to see the UUA as a lost cause in the current culture wars, as they are sometimes called. I hope that I'm wrong, and I also hope things will eventually turn around, although I don't expect them to do so at least in the UUA, any sooner than the next decade. Just because that's how long it takes things to work their way out. And this is so because the UUA is rather isolated, insignificant, and a mostly unknown organization, which means that it can cling to its failed ideology for a lot longer than many more prominent liberal organizations that are already recognizing the detrimental impacts of this failed ideology infecting their organizations. And this is the good news. There are now enough liberal organizations on life support that they are looking for a cure to this madness. When I was at the Heterodox Academy's 2022 annual conference in Denver last month, along with Shane and Stephanie Groenholz. Shane, thank you so much for pointing my attention to it. Enjoyed it very much. I bumped into one of my heroes on the elevator, Camille Foster. Shane's a fanboy too, aren't you? So Foster is a co-host of the popular Fifth Column podcast and is a lead producer for Freethink Media Company, among many other impressive accomplishments. You might have seen him host, be one of the guests on Bill Maher and other programs over the years. So I introduced myself on the elevator as soon as he walked in, you know, trying not to act like a teenager. Meeting a rock star or something. But I introduced myself, and I was surprised that he remembered hearing about my difficulties going up against the cancel culture, you know, 3 years ago, and asking me how things had turned out and how I'm doing. And I was relieved as we continued talking for him to say that he believes that this troubling mindset has already reached its peak and is beginning to wane. And that was really good news. And I agreed with him, and I hope that we're both correct. So the good news is that progressive organizations already have the fix for this disaster built in. Progressive organizations already have the fix that is necessary. We don't have to figure out how we're going to counter it. We simply need to reinstitute and recommit to the values that make us liberal organizations to begin with. Right? You've heard me say them over and over these past 3 years. Freedom, reason, tolerance. Freedom, reason, tolerance. That's what Renaissance thinking and Enlightenment thinking are founded upon. And this is at the heart of what we mean by heterodoxy, also referred to as the HXA way by the organization. And I'm going to share, before I give you that intentional definition, I'm going to share its five characteristics, because you're going to understand what it means more by understanding the characteristics that define it, right? And these are as stated by the Heterodox Academy itself, which I'm confident you will agree could be your own principles, as well as those principles that are upheld in our liberal religion. Or should be. So number one, make your case with evidence. Reason. Right? Make your case with evidence. Link to that evidence whenever possible, or describe it when you can't. Any specific statistics, quotes, and novel facts should have ready citations for credible resources. Obviously, it's an academic organization, so this is a lot about writing papers. But make your case with evidence. Whenever I am in a conversation and I hear people say, I think this, I think that, I think this, I think that, I just tune out. Because if what you think isn't accompanied by why you think it, it's pointless. It's just coming from within. There's 7.5 billion of us on the planet. Right? That's no way to ascertain what truth is, what somebody thinks or what somebody feels. Why? Why? Make your case with evidence. That's what it means to be reasonable. Number two, be intellectually charitable. Be intellectually charitable. Viewpoint diversity is not incompatible with moral or intellectual rigor. In fact, it actually enhances moral and intellectual agility. However, one should always try to engage with the strongest form of a position one disagrees with. Engage with the strongest form of a position that one disagrees with. That is, steel man opponents rather than straw manning them. Right. If you disagree with somebody, be able to find the strength of that position. As if you were going to be able to argue it for yourself. They call this the ideological Turing test, where you understand your opponent's position well enough that if you argued it yourself, those who heard you would think that you agreed with it. Look for reasons why the beliefs others hold may be compelling under the assumption that others are roughly as reasonable, informed, and intelligent as oneself. Okay, number three, be intellectually humble. Take seriously the prospect that you might be wrong. Because we are wrong. We're wrong. My philosophy professor, Dr. Roark, used to say, no human statement is ever adequate. No human statement is ever adequate. Right? We can look out into the heavens, which is about as vast a view as we can perceive, and we're not even perceiving an infinitesimally small fraction of all that is left in the universe. Right? Our knowledge is inadequate. So we certainly are wrong to some extent. So be humble. Number four, be constructive. The objective of most intellectual exchanges should not be to win the argument, right? But rather to have all parties come away from an encounter with a deeper understanding of our social, aesthetic, and natural worlds. We should be trying to understand and learn from these encounters, not to win them. Again, what's the point? What's the point? My email is filled every day with hundreds of emails from people arguing with each other. And the arguments just keep changing. The subjects keep changing. I can't even remember why I'm on this email group. It was originally to work on a problem. Now they just argue with each other. You know? I mean, why? 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 I mean, people write pages in response to what somebody has said, and I think why? What good is it going to do? I convince you that I'm right, and then I've changed the world? No. Because there's 7.5 billion people in the world, right? So it doesn't do us any good to talk to win. We should talk to learn. We should talk to gain. So be constructive. And that means trying not to insult those we disagree with with ad hominem attacks by likening them to Hitler or to Stalin or Orwellian or those sort of things. Unless they are. And then finally, be yourself. Be yourself. As they say at the Heterodox Academy, we believe that successfully changing unfortunate dynamics in any complex system or institution will require people to stand up. See, that's the moment we're in. I say we live at a time that this is our moment in history. This is what's happening around us. How are we going to respond to it? Heterodoxy says be yourself by being courageous. It takes courage to be yourself, right? It's taken courage to be yourself since you were a child, hasn't it? Does it ever stop having to have courage to be yourself? Right? It's part of being in society. We have to sometimes be courageous. To leverage and indeed stake their social capital on holding the line, pushing back against adverse trends, and leading by example. This not only has an immediate and local impact, it also helps spread awareness, provides models for others to follow, and creates permission for others to stand up as well. This is why Heterodox Academy does not allow for anonymous membership. Now, again, this is an organization of academics, right? So you could understand why academics might want to be anonymous given the situation that they're in, given the fear under which they are working. Yeah, I'll join, but I don't want anyone seeing my name on your list. No, Heterodox, no, we don't have any anonymous membership. Membership is a meaningful commitment precisely because it is public. So be yourself. Make your case with evidence. Be intellectually charitable. Be intellectually humble. Be constructive. Be yourself. These are the principles that enable us to put heterodoxy into practice. Now, for that intentional definition, heterodoxy is the opposite of orthodoxy. Now you're like, oh, okay. Now it all makes sense. You really should have started with that, though. So the suffix dox comes from the Greek word meaning idea, belief, or opinion. So orthodox refers to the right belief or the correct belief or the one belief, which is why orthodontist, straighten teeth, correct teeth, right? They are making teeth right. They're putting them in place, right? So hetero, on the other hand, means different or other. Heterodox then refers to having other ideas, ideas that are different from the orthodox beliefs. So you can understand why the heterodox way is the solution to the ideological tribalism and intolerance of our day. Exposing ourselves to different ideas and other beliefs and becoming more tolerant of those who hold them. That is the solution, which is a big part of liberalism. In liberalism today, the orthodox idea, however, the one idea, the right idea, regards an approach to greater diversity, equity, and inclusion that is based on critical race theory, which I won't go into, only to say that many people think there are other, better approaches. But the conflict that arises from this isn't over ideological differences. That's not what it's about. It's over the utter unwillingness of those who think they have the right idea to tolerate those who speak in other ways, of those who say things they disagree with. Those who dare are immediately condemned as modern-day heretics under the guise of racist, homophobe, transphobe, and so on. Conservatives, on the other hand, who don't seem to care as much about racial issues, and I'm not saying they don't care at all, but in mass, this is not a major issue from that block of our society, are quick to label, dismiss, and denigrate anyone they disagree with as liberal, using the term liberal as a slur. There are also many of us who not only care about racial justice, but are also concerned about other significant issues. We are heterothematic, if you will. We think reproductive freedom and global warming and homelessness and immigrant rights and criminal justice and income equality and academic freedom are, among other social matters, also important issues that must be addressed. The Heterodox Academy focuses mostly on how such intolerance is impacting academia, and its members are academics who support open inquiry, viewpoint diversity, and constructive disagreement in research and education. It currently has over 5,000 members, 14% of whom identify as conservatives, 17% as progressives, 30% as moderate, and 26% as liberal, all of whom, as I witnessed at the HXA conference, not only tolerate each other, but get along with great enthusiasm and joy. Despite their differences, they engage as friends. Right? That used to describe our Unitarian churches. No matter our differences, we get along as friends. That's not why we're here. We're not here to convert people's heads. So while there, I attended a fascinating lecture by a professor of medieval history. It was entitled Canceling, and was a comparative analysis of the medieval Inquisition with today's cancel culture. And the parallels between these past and present mindsets are disturbing. And I was so impressed with this professor's polished, enthusiastic, and scholarly presentation that I presume she must have given it several times. So after she was through, I asked, in the group setting, if this was something that she teaches in her classes, hoping to hear how her students might respond to it. And to my surprise and sadness, she and many others in the room laughed, a scoffing laugh at the suggestion. You're like, you must be kidding. And it was clear to me in that moment that it would be foolhardy in today's climate for a history professor, an expert in her field, to risk offending what has become the status quo. The moment helped me better understand and sympathize with what college professors and other in academia are now going through. To be afraid to say what you want and to teach what you should, because you might be condemned on social media and out of work the next day, must be terribly oppressive. It also makes me sad knowing that so many college students aren't able to have their minds truly opened by professors who have far more to offer than what they are allowed to give. This is much different than my life-changing, mind-opening, and mind-bending college experience not so long ago. And I can guarantee you my professors were not afraid of me. Fortunately, I left the HXA conference, the Heterodoxy conference, with lots of hope, because it has become clear to me that a shift has occurred in our larger society, the beginnings of a swing back in a saner direction that's based on the values many of us hold dear, and that some of us have even made a religion out of, right? Freedom, reason, tolerance. As difficult as it is for me to admit, I don't have much hope that the Unitarian Universalist Association, which really is just our service organization, will come to its senses anytime soon. But I do have much more hope that our society has reached a turning point, and that our perennial values will again become our prevailing values as more of us come to realize, as the Heterodox Academy puts it, great minds don't always think alike. Or as our liberal religion has been saying all along, we need not think alike to love alike. Thank you.
If you'll please rise as you're willing and able to sing together a little Bob Dylan, Blowing in the Wind. Yeah, the words are in your order of service or on the screen.
As we close today, I want to share the words of Reverend Dr. Michael Schuller. Cherish your doubts, for doubt is the servant of truth. Question your convictions, for beliefs too tightly held strangle the mind and its natural wisdom. Suspect all certitudes, for the world whirls on. Nothing abides. Yet in our inner rooms full of doubt, inquiry, and suspicion, let a corner be reserved for trust. For without trust, there is no space for communities to gather or for friendships to be forged. Indeed, this is the small corner where we connect and reconnect with each other. Amen. Blessed be. Salam aleikum and shalom.
Bradley?